Michele Segretario is a second-year graduate student of musicology at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. His research project about cultural mobility, traveling sounds, examines the Italian diaspora in the United States through the study of sounds and musical practices related to religion, everyday life, and entertainment. His interests include popular music and media studies. Michele completed his BA Music Disciplines and MA Musicology at the University dello Studio di Palermo, Italy.
Welcome. I would like to thank you, all the people at the Calantra Institute, for arranging this magnificent conference, and above all, Dr. Sciorra for supporting my research about the sound of the Italian American communities when this project was just less than a vague idea.
Just to say that it's the computer that's humming. Oh. I mean, that connection is making that humming. Like Carmine just told me, just so you know.
Okay, thank you. The Fisherman's Feast is an annual religious feast that takes place in the North End and dates back to a 16th century tradition from Sciacca, a town in Sicily, in southern Italy. It is a celebration worshipping the Madonna del Soccorso, which is still celebrated by Sciacca's fishermen in Sicily. Today, I will discuss the results of a 7-day field work that I conducted in Boston's North End from the 15th to the 21st August 2016. I used tools borrowed from ethnography, sound studies, and ecology to propose an interpretative model of the fisherman's feast. I will demonstrate that both the early fishermen of the North End and their descendants have been involving in a continuous process of building a soundscape, in which the sonic expression is functional to get a mythic place and to make it habitable. This mythic place assumed different connotations over time, from the village of origin in Sicily to Italy, back to the historicized North End. In the first part of this talk, I will give you some general information about the context of the Italian diaspora and the articulation of the Fisherman's Feast. In the second part, I will show you an analysis of the data I gathered in the field. At the beginning of the 20th century, when the Sicilian fishermen in Boston began celebrating the Madonna del Soccorso, they were not the only ones to bring Italian traditions to the neighborhood. Other Italians coming from different villages in the south also began to celebrate the patron saints of their homeland. St. Anthony from Montefalcone, St. Joseph from Brieci, Santa Rosalia from Palermo, and several others. All these celebrations were run by corresponding societies, which still exist today, related to what Augusto Ferraiuolo defined, quote, ethnic enclaves based on the village of origin, end quote, whose perimeters were well defined. The geography of the Italian settlement in the North End is with its several societies of saints connected to different towns in southern Italy, is the result of a village-based diaspora. In the Italian diaspora, the villages of origins played a crucial role in defining migrant identity. Since the idea of a nation with an ethnic group sharing a language and culture did not yet exist for Italians, even after the unification of 1861, and at least up until World War I. The Italian settlement in Boston's North End mirrors the typical socio-political fragmentation that continued to characterize Italy during the years of the Great Migration of 1876-1915. The fisherman's feast developed during these initial conditions. The Sicilians from Sciacca, one of the larger groups in the North End, lived on the North Street, Fleet Street, and Clark Street, in an area that was very close to the sea, given that they were fishermen. The Fisherman's Society building, which they also called the club, was built by Sciacca fishermen in 1951-52 on Fleet Street and Lewis Street. The role of the building in establishing a lasting connection between the members is of paramount importance if we consider that only about 10% of the society's members are still living in the North End. The majority of the community members are now spread all over the country because of gentrification. But during the week of celebrations for the Madonna, they all gather at the club to celebrate their patron saint. The Fisherman's Feast starts on a Thursday with a solemn procession of the Madonna, which moves to the waterfront for the annual blessing of the fishing waters. Then 2 days of shows and entertainment follow, during which I witnessed the reenactment of the Carnival Shaka, performances of opera arias, and live music. On Sunday, the grand procession takes place around the whole North End. The Madonna is carried by 12 people for 10 straight hours along the North End streets, following the route that I've traced on this map. During field research, my central question was, how does this community select its sounds? Starting with this question, I compiled the following chart. The sounds constitute the feast soundscape. In order to analyze the role of sounds within the fisherman's feast and the complex symbolic system they underpin, I classified them into 9 specific categories, based on their function or nature. This resulted in a multi-layered soundscape that allowed me to highlight the symbolic shift that occurred within the fisherman's feast over the years, and how the needs of the community changed too. To understand the changes in the soundscape means to understand the functional shift that has occurred in the fisherman's feast and within the community. Sounds from the first 5 rows are closely associated to the grand procession and articulate its several phases. The sounds of transition fall under the expressive typology of ritual noise. The shouts of invocation of the Madonna are usually performed by anyone wanting to celebrate the Madonna at any time during the procession, and when the grand procession stops, by the other society's club to pay respect to the other saints. Here, the member of the Fisherman's Society perform the typical shouts of invocation of the Madonna, but substituting the name of the Madonna with the name of the saint to whom they're paying respect. This is a way of strengthening their relationship with the other Italian-American groups in the North End. But invocation of the various saints' names triggers a metonymic chain leading directly to the village in Italy with which each saint is connected. In other words, the procession, with its multiple stops, actually map a new geography on the whole neighborhood, where specific landmarks become towns, proclaimed such by precise sonic code. In this video, I will show you how the Church of Sacred Heart is transformed into the Palermo Cathedral. The carriers shout, "Viva Santa Rosalia," in front of the statue of the patron saint of Palermo, which has been brought outside in the church to wait for the Madonna. Through this spatial and sonic strategy, the fishermen implant southern Italy within the perimeter of Boston's North End. While you're watching the video, pay attention also to the other shout performed by a woman once the marching band stops playing.
Blessed art thou amongst women, blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
Orando del soccorso, saludo Santa Rosalia! Viva Santa Rosalia!
Viva!
Viva Santa Rosalia!
Viva!
Viva Santa Rosalia!
Viva!
The shout is the most prominent signal sound of the whole feast, and is performed several times throughout the procession. Through a particular emission that produces a guttural sound. The sound is similar to those commonly heard in the road food markets of southern Italy, yelled out by sellers to promote fish and other goods, and which is called a bagnata in Sicily. In this case, the shout is given a new function. It is no longer used to focus attention on the fish, but on the Madonna, maintaining the same vocal technique, but with different contents. When the celebration of the Madonna del Soccorso di Sciacca landed in Boston's North End, its local and regional identity was reframed within a broader national context, within which the early settlers started to develop their Italianness even earlier than Italians in Italy. The society built a musical network with the New York area from which artists like Gilda Mignonette and Joe Masiello were booked to perform Neapolitan and Italian songs during the feast. While symphonic marches and opera arias constituted most of the repertoire of the marching bands. These three genres have a close correlation, which ends up generating a powerful semiotic tool to amplify the communication of a rising nationalistic feeling. Some of the most popular Neapolitan songs were composed by or attributed to opera composers like Mercadante, Donizetti, and Bellini, or poets like Salvatore Rosa, who acted as the guarantors of aptness of Neapolitan song. The most popular arias by these composers were performed by sopranos and tenors during the Fisherman's Feast, as well as by the marching band. And the symphonic marches performed in the marching band competition were often arrangements of operas, overtures, or compositions inspired by opera, as the left is now. This is an example of transtextual poetics, where each text is useful to understand the others, a dynamic textual network in which the use of redundancy allows the homogeneous elements to emerge and be recognized. Through music, the early fishermen in the North End triggered a process of textual historicization that led them to a mythic production, to an imagined Italy. The advent of fascism gave the community additional tools which facilitated the development of the nationalistic aspects within the Fisherman's Feast. According to Gaetano Salvemini, the mutual aid society created to help the transition to the million Italian immigrants into the new world became pivotal in this process of fascistization. Massachusetts was one of the states in which fascist activity was most prevalent during the interwar years. The 1935 Italian colonial expansion in Ethiopia, moreover, heightened the sympathy of Italian immigrants toward fascism and Mussolini, both of which now embodied a sense of greatness and power, of which the Italian immigrants could be proud. This is the framework within which the fisherman society began to use in the feast songs of military and fascist inspiration. Faccetta Nera is a song written by Renato Micheli with music by Mario Ruccione in 1935, and it was used as fascist propaganda regarding Italy's interest in Ethiopia. In particular, it was used to denounce slavery still practiced in the area and to justify military intervention and the subsequent campaign of African colonization. In the next video, I will show you how the residents of the North End threw their offerings to the Madonna by unrolling long ribbons from their houses, windows, or balconies, as the marching band plays the fascist song Marchetta Nera, Little Black Face. Other songs of fascist inspiration are played during the feast. The Marcia Reale, the military march that you already heard in the video with the shouts. And Giovinezza, the official anthem of the National Fascist Party. If a marching band were to play the songs in Italy today, it would be accused of making an apology for fascism. But the isolation of people in diaspora from the homeland keeps the repertoire and the ritual immune to the changes that have occurred in the country of origin, establishing a sort of pure style that needs to be perpetuated in order to ensure its effectiveness. Fascist and military songs are still played in Lawrence and New York during Italian feasts related to Catholic saints, as I learned during my fieldwork. It seems that the repertoire used by the fascist regime to celebrate itself and the new idea of nation and the artists that were involved in performing this repertoire, as well as Neapolitan songs and opera arias, must have benefited from the network built by the fascist propaganda, but this will require further research. While it is safe to say that the Fisherman's Feast soundscape became a perfect synthesis of Italianità just 30 years after the first celebration in 1906. Today's Fisherman's Feast has become a very expensive event, and since the 1980s, the society has decided to invest all its energies in increasing the popularity of the feast, while the goal of becoming, with the goal of becoming the main event of the North End. To do so, the feast soundscape was enriched with live concerts of rock and roll, soul music, and Italian-American music from the 50s, 60s, and 70s. This music displays a continuous swing among Italianists, Italian-Americanists, and Americanists. But it's also a recreation of an imagined North End, the North End where the majority of the members of the Fisherman Society grew up. Pascal Gangi is a young member of the Fisherman Society. He's just 26 years old and joined the society about 5 years ago. Pascal is the only one among the almost 80 male members of the society to be fluent in Italian and, unlike the others, to go back to Sicily every year. He began to put into the feast elements from the Commedia dell'Arte, staged by a crew called Lazzi Pazzi and the Carnival of Sciacca, which is now the most popular feast in Sciacca in Sicily, symbolized by the mask of Peppe Nappa. Pascal and his team handcrafted a floor shaped as a boat, named Sciacca, decorated with Peppe Nappa and other symbols of Sicily on it. On Saturday afternoon, the boat leads the carnival parades on Moon Street, accompanied by original music composed to celebrate the carnival in Sciacca. This is the only moment in the whole feast when it is possible to hear one of the sound marks and see one of the most prominent icons of the Sicilian village. But the rest of the community shows a certain unfamiliarity with this new element of the feast. The descendants of the Sciacca fishermen frame the village of Sciacca within a larger national Italian background. The use of music in the past decades had an essential role in smoothing the borders between the village and the nation. Returning to my question, how does this community select its sound? I answer by saying that the early fishermen of the North End built their soundscape according to the strategic reasons for survival, adaptation, and domestication of space. The festive system of the Fisherman's Feast, as I witnessed during my field research in 2016, is articulated around three crucial lines: the absence of a mythic place, the continuous and utopian attempts to bring that mythic place to the neighborhood, and the dialectic relationship between Americanness and Italianness. In spatial terms, the dialectic of absence generates a mechanism of fascination, which consequences and narrative tension facilitate processes of house-making. For the early fishermen, to transplant their village in the North End to their feast was an attempt to subvert their subdominant position with a power hierarchy, affirm their identity and possession of the neighborhood, and therefore their survival against marginalization. Until the 1980s, the original function of the grand procession and the ritual practices connected with the fisherman's feast were the domestication of a new space, the North End. The early community of fishermen not only went out on the streets of the neighborhood to fill the space with their symbols and sounds, but they established an immediate habitability of the neighborhood by arranging provisional domestic spaces on the streets with tables and food. Moreover, the 10-hour procession, the multiple crossing of another street, the construction of the building enshrined the appropriation of the neighborhood by an ethnic minority, and at the same time, the attempt to broaden the knowledge of both a new place and the place of origin. Third and fourth generation Italian Americans don't fear the threat of marginalization experienced by their ancestors. They are not scared by an unknown space anymore, for the simple reason that America is now their homeland, and thus a well-known space, and the North End was historicized as a sort of big and harmless souvenir. Therefore, the alternative place that they recreate each year through their sounds is a more controlled space with a lower level of unpredictability. This creates a safe space, free from fear of being swallowed up by the socioeconomic system that their ancestors chose for them. Within the transformative aspects enacted by the fisherman's sound, the North End became a transnational and meta-historical space. Since 1906, the fishermen have been building a multi-layered soundscape where each passage created interaction with one or more of the identities displayed by the community in relation to the neighborhood. The result of this process is an inversion of the push-pull migration model. The early settlers began to organize the feast to go back home, while their descendants worked to escape from their American homes and go back to the neighborhood. At the end of my field research, when I said goodbye to Therese, Saudi Ishidua's wife, the former president of the society, she asked, "Are we close?" She meant, "Are we close to what happens in Sicily?" In that moment, I realized that was not a question, but an answer to all of the questions I had asked during my time in the field. The American version of the Fisherman's Feast indeed produces an asymptotic model, a progressive and never conclude approach to the homeland. Something is always missed in this representation, and this something is imagined, mythologized. Because of the importance of music in the process of community building, the Sicilian community in the North End is to be considered as a musical community. Music helped and still helps the community in the North End to understand the several places within which it has been involved, whether they be real or imagined. Matteo Meschiari is right when he says that now the unknown land had migrated in different areas of the solar system and maybe beyond, end quote. True, but within a microcosm like the Fisherman's Feast, it is possible to find an elsewhere, and above all, the tension toward this elsewhere. The long and cathartic route covered by carriers through mortification of the body while they are marching following the rhythm of a swing version of a sole mio is one of the attempts to get this elsewhere. This should not be confused with Christian heaven, the elsewhere of the Sicilian carriers. The space of the North End, in which the descendants of the fishermen of old are still acting today, will remain always a new space, where there will always be some gaps to fill, new elsewheres that need to be discovered year after year, even though it has been more than a century since the first celebration.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I have a question about the La Faccetta Nera, the song. When I was little, my mother used to tell me that my grandfather was not at all prejudiced against black people. And the proof was that he was always singing that song about the beautiful black faces of Ethiopia. So I thought that that was a song that my grandfather had brought over from Italy when he came over around 1910 or something like that. He was a very strong supporter of Roosevelt and was very proud to be an American citizen and very strong Democrat. He lived in the Italian community in Albany, which was a few thousand families, it wasn't that big, but concentrated. I never knew the song wasn't written until 1935, until I just saw this here. So I'm going, how in the world did my grandfather learn this song? How did this become a song that he was singing all the time? Was it on the radio in Albany? I mean, did the Italians bring, is that what happened? I mean, I just don't understand how someone who was a Democrat here was singing a song that was for to celebrate fascism in Italy.
That's interesting question. I mean, I don't think I have an answer to this question, so how I learned the song. But I can tell that this song, the song is so popular, both associated to fascism and to Italianness, above all among the immigrants. So at one point, it looks like the immigrants, for some reason, detached this song from ideology.
Okay.
And the song became to display just Italianness and proudness, proud of this nation that was arising in this new Europe, in this new colonial Europe. So probably that could have been the path that led your father or your ancestors.
Maybe they just didn't even realize what it really meant.
Yeah, or maybe just, yeah. For example, the community in Boston completely knows that this is a fascist song. They know that, but they say, yeah, okay, but it's an Italian song. So I think that the answer is in their reaction to my question. How do you how are you playing precious songs to celebrate the Catholic saint? That was so shocking for me, coming from Italy, doing field research on that. At one point, they started to play the fascist song, military songs. Also, they played the fascist part, the anthem of the fascist party.
I have a question, but just an answer to this whole issue of the facetta nera and giovinezza. You have to keep in mind that the Italian government, the fascist government, was a strong propaganda machine that had operatives here in the consulates who were constantly promulgating fascism in the United States to the Italian immigrants, and in particular the radio stations. From Boston to Philly and elsewhere were often had fascist operatives on it as well, up until Pearl Harbor. So it's an important thing. One comment, in the 1980s Giglio Feast, when there were still World War II American veterans, Italian-American veterans who were much more alive, I remember seeing the band playing Facetta Nera, and the Italian-American ex-GI from World War II was so enraged and so angry that he went up to the band leader and publicly told them to stop playing this fascist song, because we fought the fascists, that's what he said. So I have a question, though. Wonderful presentation, thank you so much. It's great to hear it here at the Calandra Institute. The idea that the Italians in Boston, Italian-Americans in Boston, are looking for this imaginary Sicily, trying to get back home, I'm curious about the relationship of the Italian-Americans, American-born, and the new immigrants, the post-World War II immigrants, and because you mentioned this person who was born in Italy, goes back each year, to what degree that influence of new Italian immigrants changes the perception and the musical landscape for the Italian-Americans that are there in Boston?
Thank you. Thank you for the question, and thank you for your feedback about the fascism in the U.S. community, in the Italian-American community in the U.S. Okay, so the third and fourth generation Italian-Americans in Boston, I argue that they added other sounds to the soundscape chart that I have here, somewhere in the slide here. And, okay, so basically my argument is that while the pre-80s sound bringing the community back to Sicily, the new sounds bring the community back to the North End. They historicize the North End. So they're celebrating, they're still keeping the sound from the tradition, okay? But they had a sound, so they built this kind of multi-layered soundscape where they just had the sound from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, so sounds of the youth. So this way I think that they are framing Shaka no more as a village, but as a broader context, as an Italian context. So did I answer to your question?
Yeah, I think. We could have a conversation ongoing after the
Okay.
Joe had mentioned it is okay to take a couple more questions. One more question.
Michele, thank you so much. That was such an amazing presentation. I wanted to, still in keeping with this kind of facetta nera and like depoliticizing motion that has been made of it, I was wondering if by any chance there were any kind of other political songs like that. Okay, let me rephrase my question. If when you talk to your people who you're talking to, I don't know if you would call them your informants in this case, whether or not they have a kind of concrete idea of what fascism was and what facetta nera means, what the words mean. You mentioned only one is fluent in Italian. That's my question, if that's okay. Un po' banale.
Thank you. No, I don't think it's a banal question. Okay, so I think I don't know if they are familiar with the contents of the song. I know that they are completely aware that these songs, this repertoire, is related with the fascist regime in Italy. So there is a political, the songs have the political impact in Italy. At the same time, I don't know if they are aware of the this marginalization that these songs promote against the women also. Because it's not just a song of promoting colonialism in Ethiopia, so the colonial campaign in Ethiopia is also a song that they are saying to the women, to the Ethiopian women, we will free you from the slavery, but we will embed in a slavery of love. So this kind of myth of the Blair women that could be for some reason kept from the Italians for whatever purposes.
Thank you.